Jesus' name, amen. It was about 10 years ago or so that, it was 10 years, I remember, because it was after my daughter and son-in-law married. And I was working through some health issues in the fall and then early in the winter. And both events of those health issues demanded some extended time in the hospital. The one element was we were in for about 15 days, and then the second run was about 14 days. And you know, any day in the hospital seems like eternity. And the first round was I had acutely inflamed pancreas, and I guess there was some question, well, I was going to make it. Well, I'd be here.
Amen.
And the second round was going to be was a matter of a simple remove of the gallbladder, which is usually an hour and a half, 2 hour surgery. The head nurse at Strong came in and found Diane a little over 4 hours after the time that the procedure started. And come to find out that was a very challenging surgery for her. But I guess I lost a lot of weight. And I remember at that time I was feeling well enough to go ahead and interact with the men's Bible study, which Don had up at the shop. And but it took quite a while for me to recover at home. My dear and faithful wife was there for me. I could not get up and navigate from the chair in the living room into the bedroom without her coming alongside and helping me walk. I was that weak when I came home. So I had to, after I started to get the feeling a little bit better, I had to do some things to help me to strengthen myself more. So I, at that time, we were raising potatoes. And we marketed the potatoes in 5-pound bag, 10-pound bag, 20-pound bag, and 50-pound bag. So I said, well, we got, this is available. So I started and I reached out with a 5-pound bagger and I started to doing, you know, the reps, you know, like you guys. How many of you lift weights? I know, Jeremy, you do. Are you still or used to?
Long time ago.
Yeah, not as long as it was for me. I saw another hand, okay? One of the Smith boys work with weights. But you start out, you don't start out with the big weights. You're taking the small weights and you start working with them and you're working up and you're building yourself up so you can, then you get a number of reps in that particular weight area, and then you move up to the next. So I moved from the 5-pounder, and I did that, and I moved up to the 10, and then I moved from the 10 up to the 20, and then went up to the 50, and I thought, wow, I'm really gaining. So then I went back to the 5-pounder, and that's when I put some potatoes in the bag. Was that worth the wait? I remember I think, I don't know if I sent that to you, Mike, as an email. And I remember Gene came up to me. He said, I was reading that. And then I saw the last line, and he said, wow, you got me good. You got me good. But you know, There's a lot of parallels in that whole process spiritually. You know, we read through Hebrews 11 and we say, ah, I want to do that. And we look at that passage that we looked at in Matthew, talk about if you'd have faith like a mustard seed, you can move mountains. It's like we kind of have in our heads, yeah, Lord, I want to move mountains. Give me some of that faith dust so I can end up moving the mountains. And our concept and our understanding of this whole element of faith is so wrong. So wrong. Now, take your Bibles and look with me to Job. And I love Job. I can, some of the health issues I've run through in my life, I can kind of relate to Job, but just a smidgen. None of our lives have ever been in the same scenario that Job has been in. None of us. In fact, you can probably take almost all of us and put us in a group and still come short of that which Job had to walk through in his life. Job starts out, chapter 1, and there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless. He was upright. He was one who feared God, and he turned away from evil. When God put his inspiration on the scriptures, that was the get-go. That was a way the introduction to Job started out. Now, when Satan and Jesus Christ, God, interacted, drop down to chapter 1, verse 8. And the Lord said to Satan, hey, have you considered my servant Job? You know, there's none like him. None like him on this earth. He is blameless. He is upright. He's one who fears God. And he turns away from evil. And God was telling Satan that, okay, you can put your hand on Job and make some difficult times come into his life because I trust Job. Job is a man that his heart glorifies and honors me. Chapter 2, taking a look at verse 3, after a period of time of Satan's harassing Job, Satan comes back again before the Lord, goes to and fro upon the earth, walking up and down in it. And in verse 3, the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? All that Job walked through, that Satan handed out, this is God's response to Satan the second time. Have you considered my servant Job? There is none like him on the earth. He's blameless. He's an upright man. He fears God. And he turns away from evil. You see, there's an inner quality in the life of Job that God saw, representing that Job had an intimate relationship and walk with God. I just am so impressed. That scripture starts out that statement about Job. God speaks to Satan about those qualities, not just once, but twice. That, to me, that is just so incredible. Job was God-focused, blameless, upright. He feared God, and he turned away from evil. Now, I've been thinking about this passage and this whole section of Hebrews 11 for a long time. And I thought of different ones that I just pulled some names kind of out of the air. And I wanted to take a look at their lives. Think about Moses. So I went through the scripture and tried to pull different highlights about Moses out. I've looked at Job. I'm looking at Moses now. And there's a lot in the scripture that addresses Moses. You can take an exhaustive concordance and you can go through the name of Moses and you go back to those passages and, oh, wow, it's rich. I took a look at Exodus chapter 40. You can jot these passages down, Exodus 40. And then Hebrews 3:11, Hebrews 11:24, Hebrews 12:21. I'll repeat those for those who are jotting them down. Exodus 40, verse 16, Hebrews 3:11. Hebrews 11:24, Hebrews 12:21. Those are just four of the passages that I drew some thoughts from. But you know what I find? Moses feared God. He was humble before God. He obeyed God, and he turned away from sin. It almost seemed like I'm reading about Job. There's some common characteristics in the life of Moses that are represented in the life of Job that God admired. Isn't that cruel? And then Mary. Mary, the mother of Jesus, was the other one. And this is impressive to me. I looked basically at Luke 1 from verse 26 on through 55. So I encourage you to take time to jot those down and look them up. But I saw here, again, that Mary feared God. She was humble before God. She obeyed God. And a neat characteristic that she had a heart's burden for others in need, such as Elizabeth. She went and stayed with Elizabeth. Now, you ladies, you go back and think about those early years of pregnancy. Years of, sometimes it seemed like years, didn't it? When you don't feel good, you're sick, and oh, when's this going to get over with? How long am I going to have to go face this? And some of you ladies, Ruth and my daughter-in-law, Jenna, understand that, and maybe some others that I don't recall. Seems like it's going on for eternity. But even during that time frame, for her, she had a compassion to help others. Wow. You know, you and I sometimes have a hard time helping others when we feel good. Think about it. That's true. We're busy. We are occupied. We got other things. I got people to see, places to go, things to do. And so those elements of caring and having compassion for others sometimes gets pushed off to one side. Shame on us. So far at this point, I see that Job, Moses, Mary had a priority of God in their lives. And then we go to Joseph. We don't see an awful lot in the scripture about Joseph. But there's enough there. And I drew probably most of this out of Matthew 1, 18 through 25. There's enough there that reminds us and instructs us that he was upright before God. He was obedient to God. And he was considerate of others. Was he hurt by finding out that Mary was pregnant? And they didn't even have a relationship? So in the fleshly mind, it would seem that Mary had taken on an adulterous relationship out of that with her husband. Her betrothed husband, Joseph. That had to hurt. And she had to realize that, wow, when people in the community find out, her name's going to be mud. So Joseph had to bear up underneath that. And as I go through these characteristics of these four individuals, I'm reminded that God is majorly concerned about our sincere, genuine relationship with him. Job demonstrated that. Moses demonstrated that. Mary and Joseph as well. And you see, it's out of that sincere, genuine, intimate, growing relationship with God that our ministry flows. It's, you know, Alex and Rachel, they're heading over to, they're in Scotland now, and they're all getting all revved up about the Word of Life work in this particular church, and hopefully that whole element will move out into other churches. But it's not really the Word of Life program that is the focal point, or that should be the focal point for them. It is this type of a relationship that God could take a look upon the life of Job, Moses, Mary, and Joseph, that they need to be intent upon. Because outside of that, it's just a program. It's just a lot of activities. It's just a lot of events. And I've interacted with different ones through the years about the importance of that God level relationship with God, that is where their ministry actually flows out of. And Mike, Brian, and myself, we need to be so intently in tune with that truth. Otherwise, it's just a lot of busyness. And that's not just ourselves. That's true for yourselves as well. Excuse me. Take your Bibles and turn away to Hebrews chapter 7. And I want you to see a truth that we have a tendency to sidestep. Taking a look at verse 18 through 25. Hebrews chapter 7, 18 through 25. For on the one hand, a former commandment is set aside because of its weakness and its uselessness. For the law made nothing perfect. But on the other hand, a better hope is introduced through which we draw near to God. And it was not without an oath, for those who formerly became priests were made such without an oath. But this one was made a priest with an oath by the one who said to him, "The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever." And this makes Jesus the guarantor of a better covenant. The former priests were made many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing office. But he holds his priesthood permanently because it continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Did you catch that truth over in verse 19? A better hope is introduced through which we draw near to God. What's the better hope? Jesus Christ. And it's through that hope, Jesus Christ, that we draw unto God. We find down in verse 25, consequently, he, who's the he? Jesus Christ. He, Jesus Christ, is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God. It is through Jesus Christ that we draw near unto God. John 14:6, Jesus saith, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," and what? "No man comes unto the Father but by me." It's through Christ unto the Father. Take your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 5 at this point. Taking a look at verses 11, 10 and 11. "For if we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son. Much more, now that we are reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And more than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation." Four important elements here. We are reconciled to God by the death of his Son. We were saved by his life. We rejoice in God through the Lord Jesus Christ. And then a repeat of a thought, and it's through Christ we have been reconciled to God. Paul is making it clear as he writes to the church at Rome that it's through Christ unto the Father. God focused. 1 Corinthians 11, we're talking about headship. But I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ. And the head of every wife is her husband. And the head of Christ is is gone. The head. And then in Matthew 24:36, but concerning that day, what day? Jesus was interacting with his disciples out to, when the heavens and the earth will pass away. And the disciples, what? What's going on? What do you mean? When's that going to take place? And Jesus says to them, no one knows. Not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. Wow. Are you wrapping your mind around this? It's big time. So we have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. The Trinity and all three parts of the Trinity are deity, divine. But there is a distinction in the role and the responsibility of each one. Hang on to that. If we don't walk through that, we're going to get things all muddied up. It's like, I was talking with Diane this morning, because during the night, it came to me that, wow, the beauty of the colors, what are the primary colors? Red, yellow, blue, all right? I think the primary are three, then we move into another level, okay? And those, each one, let's take just the three. You take each one of those colors, they're beautiful in themselves. But if you muddy them together, what do you end up with? Who's an artist? Come on, someone artist tell me. Brown. Yeah. Brown is just kind of, yeah. Well, there's some parallels that God put in order here. The beauty of God the Father, the beauty of God the Son, who is down at the right hand of God the Father, and then the working and the flowing of the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives today. Each one distinctively have a beauty. And if we don't understand how that flows, we're going to get very confused as we walk through Scripture. And you know, we often take this whole element and we approach it that we approach our relationship with God on a framework that, you know, if you just come to God and you accept God and we understand that we need to know God in Christ, that you won't go to hell, but you go to heaven. And you know what I found? Folks who generally come to the Lord on that premise are content to be there. It's like having a get out of jail card when you play Monopoly. You know, when I play Monopoly, and I haven't done it for a very long time, but when I get that get-out-of-jail card, I begin to play a little bit more carelessly. I'm not as cautious as how I'm going to spend the money, how and what moves and positions I'm going to respond. Because it's, and I find over the years that many times an individual that just comes to that relationship with God out of the framework that they're not going to hell, but they're going to go to heaven instead, are oftentimes content to stay there. And they never walk forward into that relationship with God in such a fashion that they're going to be blameless, upright, walking away from sin and being obedient. It very, very seldom happens. I remember I had some health issues again and ended up in Batavia. The ambulance came out. Usually takes us 15, 20 minutes to get to UMMC. That night it took us 45 because the weather was so severe in the storm. And they were allowing Diane to go in the ambulance, which is kind of unusual too, I understand. But while we were there, I heard over, and I think maybe I shared this before, but I heard over the PA system within the hospital that cardiac arrest, cardiac arrest, cold, whatever they do. And that got my attention because my dad passed away with a cardiac arrest. He went to sleep that night and he did not wake up. That had my attention. So in the consulting room, the counseling room, whatever, doctors, nurses, staff, others came in, family came in, and I finally got the issue that I was working through. I think it was AFib. He got that settled down, and Diane and I were trying to figure out how we're going to get home. So I went into that room. The wife and the mother of that man were there. And I sat down and talked to them. I said, "You guys just had some very, very hard news. I feel bad for you. My heart aches for you. But I want you to know that God knows and God cares." Their immediate response was, "Oh, we know the Lord. We're believers." I said, "Oh, that is so good, because, you know, there's no other real help or hope that we can have without that relationship with God. And right now, your church family is vitally important. Where do you go to church?" "We don't." "Where have you gone to church?" "Well, not since we accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior in VBS. They haven't been to church since that time." I struggled with that. And my friends, it's not an isolated setting. It's common that we are content that we're not going to hell, but going to heaven instead. So when you talk to individuals, speak to them on what we saw this morning, that the work of Christ on the cross is that we could come through Christ unto the Father. Over in Romans, I ask you to take there and take a look at that particular section of Scripture. We won't read it through, but I do want to draw your attention to verse 21. And I spent quite a bit of time, a couple of different times, with a young man in this church recently, looking at this portion of Scripture. Verse 21, "For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or glorify him as God," as most of the translations actually word that, "or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking." They knew God, but they did not honor him as such. You know, we looked at Job, we looked at Joseph, looked at Moses, looked at Mary. Their lives were not just that they knew God. They embraced Him. They loved Him. They made God a priority in their lives. And their characterization that we see of them made that a huge point. But we see that these ones, they know God. You walked on the street, you know, and if you take a microphone or a recorder and say, "Do you know God?" "Oh, yeah, I know of God. I know there's a God." Read the context of that Romans 1. It's powerful. It's convicting. It is so important when you and I talk to someone about their relationship that it goes beyond just getting saved, not going to hell, but going to heaven instead. It's much richer than that. It's much more directive than that. There's a big difference. Oftentimes, when we come to that point of just getting saved so we don't go to hell, we go to heaven instead, religion oftentimes is the circle of reference and thought that is there. My friends, don't just get caught in a trap of religion. God wants a relationship with you. He wants you, through Jesus Christ, to come unto Him, to love Him, to adore Him, to make Him a priority in your life. It's fundamental. And if our framework of thought is just not going to hell but going to heaven instead, I'm going to be bold to say that you're destined probably for hell, because that's all your framework is about. We need to move forward and past that point in order for that relationship to be genuine and true. It is through Christ that we come unto the Father, unto God. That kind of relationship is life-changing. Job, Moses, Mary, Joseph had a life-changing relationship because they loved and adored the Almighty God. They had a heart for God. They were God-focused in their lives. A couple, 3 months ago, I met a friend of Charles who, his name is also Charles. And Charles, you and I kind of dialogued about that. The beekeeper, what's his last name? Agron? And Charles was sharing with me that he has come to realize the importance of his relationship with walk with God. He's in his 80s. He gets up in the morning, has his morning breakfast and his coffee, and he sits down for an hour in God's Word and then in prayer. That's awesome, friends. That's awesome. He had a heart for God. God focused. I'm not sure what his earlier life was like, but he came to that point where he became God focused. And as we walk through the scripture, God is encouraging myself to be more God focused. Mike, Brian, to be more God focused in that life relationship. And through the Word, He also is encouraging each and every one of you to be more God-focused. And that comes to our heart and life relationship, understanding the purpose that God, the Father, had in sending His Son to this earth. That it's through His Son that we can come unto the Father. God desires for you and I to honor and glorify Him and make Him a priority. Chris, would you run that video? Thank you. That's exactly what Job, Moses, Mary, and Joseph had done. And their lives displayed that. And obviously, God admired that and loved that. Heavenly Father, I praise that as we walk into the Sunday school hour, Lord, we'll give attention to your heart's desire for us and our response to you as the Almighty God. And Father, if there's anyone here this morning that are in the trap of just not going to hell, but going to heaven instead, and that your Holy Spirit may have touched their lives today to help them to see that there's more to it than just that. Help them to see that that really is eye focus. That's very selfish in our thinking. And then you call us to put you as a priority, desiring our honor, our glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. I pray, Father, for anyone that's been touched, that they would come to speak to Mike or Brian or myself concerning a living, vital relationship with you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you.